Expectations. It sure can be a bitch when it comes to movies because god damn you, obligatory back of a VHS cover for this movie for muddling up this movie for me. So, I was walking in a video store in the twilight years of the VHS era, aka late 90s, when I came across this movie. I was immediately taken by the amazing artwork of the poster. It's one of the best posters of all time. And the back cover of it, especially the text on the back, just gave this fantastic, grand, tragic story of the Eastern Front that I sort of was, wow, what a great idea, what a great concept. I must see this movie at some point. I don't know if I don't actually remember whether or not I rented it or not. I don't even know what a movie from 1977 did at a video store in the late 90s, but there you go. Anyway, I saw the movie and I was sort of, well, that was sort of not what was promised to me. What was not promised? Let's take a look, shall we? This is Cross of Iron. Russian front wasn't too pleasant for the Germans. They had an overwhelming enemy with more tanks, more supplies, more men, with themselves having, you know, a lack of basically everything, and with, you know, stretch out supply lines, all that stuff. The war at this point were basically over. They just didn't know it yet. The German soldiers in this one isn't your, you know, crazy Waffen-SS, Hitler-loving lunacies that populated most other war movies. But it is mostly, you know, people who are pretty disinterested in politics and just want to get home. A rarity in war movies. Our main character, Rolf Steiner, is an Unteroffizier, some sort of lower ranking officer. Steiner is a grizzled veteran and he doesn't have any pretenses of the war. He's a cynic and he doesn't really care that much about, you know, politics like that. He just wants to try to, you know, get his men home and tries to, you know, survive. However, they're getting a new captain, Captain Stransky, played by Maximilian Schell. He has asked to be transferred from the much less action-packed and lot easier Western Front to here because he wants to earn the Iron Cross. He wants to earn the highest medal in the Wehrmacht. He wants to earn that medal more than anything else. James Coburn already has that. And at first he's sort of, ooh, you have that one. And when he discovers that James Coburn doesn't care about medals or stuff like that, it's just a piece of iron, as he says. It's just a piece of metal. It doesn't mean anything. The two men starts to get in each other's faces. Well, it doesn't help that they have very different background. He is, you know, working class. He's aristocrat, and there is that aspect too. At the same time as Stalin is just piling up more and more and more troops to the Eastern Front, and how many men is Hauptmann going to sacrifice in order to obtain the Iron Cross? That is the idea and concept that the VHS sold me on, that the movie was going to be about, and that is sort of the truth, but not really. It does have this element to it, but I thought they were gonna hammer this one home even more to make this an even more tragic and more, you know, dark story about it, but it isn't. It is there, but it is also, you know, sidelined by a lot of, you know, side plots and stuff like that, which in a sense muddles the water a little bit. This is not a bad movie. It's not a bad movie at all. It does have, you know, moments that are truly great. I mean, the acting is good. Schnell, Coburn, and also James Mason. And also, has James Mason ever made a truly bad performance? I think not. And we have Sam Peckinpah, who has a well spotty track record when it comes to movies. But generally speaking, when he's good, he's good. When he's not good, he isn't. This is a bit in the middle. Now, the action sequences filmed in Yugoslavia is great. They have, you know, great grit to it. They have great authenticity. And so what's the problem? Good acting, good battle sequences, and a pretense to actually make a great different version of the classical World War II movie is admirable. But the movie feels unfocused and, you know, as I said, some of the side plots just, you know, takes over and makes me care less for the main, you know, antagonistic driving force of this movie, you know, the Iron Cross thing. It gets a little, you know, left behind. And it doesn't help at all that this movie has maybe one of the worst endings of all time. When I saw this movie, I didn't know what happened. I was sort of, this is it. What the fuck? It's ending. What the fuck kind of ending is that? What the fuck? Why did this movie end so bad? Well, the money ran out. That's what happened. The money ran out on them. They couldn't shoot the actual ending, so the movie just stopped. Like this review would have ended right now. But that would have been stupid, right? This is a perfectly okay war movie. The battle sequences are very nicely shot. The acting is great. The angle of the conflict is great. But too many side plots obstructs what could have been a really fascinating movie. And therefore, I can only give it the rating of 47. And also, it doesn't help with the horrible ending. It's not a bad movie at all. It is just frustrating to see what could have been and what actually became of it. IMDb rating says that I'm wrong about this one, but I firmly stand my ground that I think this one is a little bit overrated. See you next time, where I will be reviewing so and so from, well, such and such. Thank you for watching. Thank you very much.